Okay.
Do it.
Live your dreams.
Now he's chopping up meat. Come inside, maybe you'll hear him say.
Real quick.
That's one of my favorite Morrissey lyrics.
The Ryer, the Kaiser.
I will say his solo stuff has taken a very different direction.
Well, I don't know how this one.
This one is awesome.
You gotta kinda. It doesn't really get into it, though.
There's a homicidal man.
Anyway. There we go. That's the best way to start off part two of the Smiths'
self-titled album. Yeah, you can't.
That
talk.
Didn't even say. Oh my god!
Oh, you should close that door.
Oh yeah.
Wait, there's nobody.
Well, it'll just help keep this.
Well.
Going. So we're back for this charming podcast. The Handsome Hooligans have joined you.
The Handsome Hooligans. Episode 3.
The self-proclaimed handsome hooligans. I mean, it's like, not only are we saying we're handsome, but we're hooligans too. I mean, have we ever roughed anybody up?
Yes.
Oh, wow. Well.
I've been roughed up several times.
Yeah, but you can't be.
That's why my sister
doesn't make you. I know that doesn't make you become a hooligan if you're getting beat up. You're getting beat up by hooligans.
Wait, so what does that make me?
Let's just say we're handsome hooligans. That's what we are. Look, go like this. Make your muscles look big. There we go. Okay.
Zier.
So, I'm Mark.
Kaz.
Steven.
And we are jumping right in to...
Right in.
Right in to... Weird Al Yankovic's in 3D. No.
No. I love Nature Trail to Hell, but also
Oh, yeah.
on 45.
But,
on 45.
No, yeah, that actually, we were listening to it while we were taking a little break. So let's get back to the Smiths' debut album, self-titled. And what song were we on?
Pretty Girls.
Oh, wait, I'm not on the wrong album. Oh my gosh. Okay, Pretty Girls Make Graves. Okay, I'm gonna take this one. Let's just listen to it.
Up on the sand, up on the bay, there is a quick and easy way you say, before you illustrate, I'd rather stay.
Alright. And then.
I'm not the man you think I am.
Chug my arm and stay.
Okay, I'm gonna just, okay, so basically, to me, this song is, he's talking about that. So this girl wants him, you know, wants to date him or whatever with him, but he's saying, I'm not the man you think I am. Actually, one thing that Morrissey talks a lot about in his autobiography is that there's all these girls that liked him and thought he was cute and stuff, but he just wasn't that way, you know, wasn't so interested in sexuality and stuff because nature made him different. So, and that's basically my take on this song.
Mm-hmm.
That he's not the you know, he's maybe, you know, a man, but nature made him a little different, so... That's my. You guys got any?
I like it because it sounds like a coy little distraction.
What do you mean?
Like, girls like him, and he's like, oh, "I'm sorry." It's like the classic Homer Simpson letdown breakup line.
What?
P.S. I'm gay.
Yes, I'm gay. You know, and that's one thing actually that Morrissey's never come out as necessarily is, you know,
I'm human sexual.
Actually,
I'm human sexual.
It is rumored that he was actually dating a girl.
Well, no, I'm not saying
they,
that he...
While they were making this album.
I know. Well, when I saw... Actually, whenever we went and saw Morrissey and Yuma, and we waited around after so to see if we could... And we followed his car, you know, and there was a girl in the backseat with him. I mean, I'm not saying... But, you know, a friend or whatever, but... I mean, I don't think he is necessarily.
And that's fine. I don't care.
Yeah, it is. But I'm saying I don't think he is necessarily that way. It's just kind of.
No, that's what I'm saying. I think this song is more of a coy little letdown. Like, I don't want to like really upset you by saying no, you're not my type. Rather than I can't, I'm gay.
Or yeah, the he should have wrote, "It's not you, it's me."
Yeah.
That could have been this way. It's not you, it's me. Oh, it's not you, it's me.
But yeah, that's the way I kind of see.
That's a nice letdown, though, to say, hey, I'm just not. That's better than
That's why I go back into it's the Homer Simpson classic letdown line.
I'm gay.
Yes, I'm gay.
Okay. Oh, go ahead, Cass.
I think a lot of the reason why he's like, oh, you know, maybe not, is because. From what it sounds like in the song, she purely wants him for sexual reasons. Like, and,
well,
you know, Morrissey's stance on sex.
Well, yeah, he's not, but, yeah, but...
Yeah, all he
what,
needs
you know,
is 15
the,
minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah, 15 minutes. That song should have been 2 or 3 minutes at most. I mean, if you want to be honest, 15 minutes, hello, marathon. But anyway. So, okay, so you guys are taking it as kind of.
All right, next track.
But no, there was something I wanted to point out, and Morrissey, you know, pointed out that he didn't like the drumming, you know, the drums are on this, in this thing. The recording, but one thing that I did pick up on is, hopefully I got it right there. You hear that? Okay.
What are we listening for?
Listen. Goes.
Oh, yeah, cowbell.
I thought that was so funny. Oh, my gosh, there's cowbell in the Smith song.
You know what this song means, more?
More cowbell, baby. And that's what Morrissey was saying whenever he talked about how much he didn't like this recording, is that they didn't turn the cowbell up enough.
Yeah.
I got a fever. For more cowbell. So, anyway, I thought that was... I was like... I never noticed that that's an actual cowbell, you know.
Okay, so let's look at some actual lyrics from the song.
All right.
She wants it now, and she will not wait, but she's too rough, and I'm too delicate. So obviously...
Delicate. I know. That's racism.
So anyway, obviously, it's about some girl who just wants him madly, passionately, and violently.
But he's just not into it.
Yeah. And then, this is the best. This is why I like it. Because he's saying, she's too rough, I'm too delicate. She wants it now, and it doesn't really matter where it's coming from. Then on the sand, another man, he takes her hand.
What? Oh, you know what? I never read that lyric. I didn't know that's what he said.
A smile lights up her stupid face.
I love that. A smile lights up her stupid face. Well, it would.
And I've lost my faith in womanhood. I've lost my faith in womanhood. I've lost my faith.
But yeah.
As you can sing, this kid's got vocals. He's got pipes.
So yeah, I think it's stupid. You know, I think that's why I think it's one of those coy little things like, you're not really my type. I don't really want to do anything with you. And I kind of despise you. And by the way, I'm gay.
Okay.
And then
she goes off with somebody else. Whatever.
And then at the very end, he says, yeah, her smile lights up her stupid face. Well, it would.
Well, yeah. So basically, unfortunately, though, for him, he's kind of mad, though, that she's She ends up walking off with somebody other.
Well, of
some
course. It's Morrissey. What do you expect?
Yeah.
I mean, if all attention is not focused on him, then, you know, he gets upset. I mean, especially now. Probably back then he was probably a little bit more humble.
Well, yeah, he's just starting.
All right,
okay,
let's move
so
on
let's
to Kimberly.
Kimberly. Here goes the...
In honesty, and full disclosure, I've never heard the song Kimberly. But the reason I like this song so much is because if you listen to the guitar, to the bass, and to the drums, all the emphasis is on the downbeat, not the upbeat.
Okay.
So it's because the thing is when the music is more on the downbeat, it sets more of a ominous tone.
Wait, so you're saying it's on the downbeat? No.
Yeah,
okay.
It's on the down, so all the emphasis is on the downbeat. And I really like the chord progression in this because it's kind of off. It's not necessarily a regular, like, melodic. And when I say melodic, I mean things like you would think of, like, Happy Cheery. Ah!
Oh yeah, it's definitely
progression,
not that.
Progression.
Yeah.
It's very much a darker, more brooding chord progression.
So
and again, I don't know what Kimberly sounds like, so I can't say if that's the same thing.
Do you?
Kimberly. I've listened to it once or twice, but
I don't know. Well, okay, so what's this song about? I mean, I always, you know, it's got those haunting lyrics about the shadows, ceiling shadows, shimmy by, or
I think this is
and
another,
a candle and a ghost. And
I kind of think this is another like very mid-60s song, I guess, like a mid-60s kitchen sink drama that Morrissey wanted to write, like Sheila Delaney. It's very Sheila Delaney-esque, I guess.
Sheila Delaney?
She's the girl that wrote A Taste of Honey, and also we can kind of assume, you know, it's who Sheila Take a Bow is about.
Oh.
Yep.
There we go.
Yeah.
Well, so yeah, you just, to me, it's always been like a sweet song about this guy that's going to care for this kid and, you know, like, the scared of the dark and monsters and boogeymen and stuff. So I've always liked it, and I think it'd be a neat lullaby, you know.
Except
like, it's pretty dark.
Yeah. I mean, like, it starts out like that, and then you get closer to the end of the song, and you're like, this is really, like, ooh, this is kind of foreboding.
Okay, you got Rock-a-bye Baby, the cradle will rock, when the cradle will fall, and down will come baby.
The hand that rocks the cradle.
Yeah.
As long as the hand that rocks the cradle is not me.
Wait, I thought you said, as long as the hand that rocks the cradle is mine. Right? I mean...
Oh, it might be, yeah.
Yeah, I thought he was saying...
As long as the hand that rocks the cradle is mine.
So taking care of, but then there's this woman in there that
This is the way I see it. This is the way I see it.
Okay.
And this is just my interpretation on the song itself. It's just a very sad soap is what I'm seeing here, where a woman loses her child and is haunted by this baby's ghost.
What?
And that's the other song.
No,
this is The Hand That Rocks the Cradle.
Okay.
And so the thing.
What about
that
movie though?
What movie?
Did you see that?
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle?
Yeah. Where the lady's like a tree lady, right?
No, that.
But she's walking around naked a lot of the time.
What are you talking about?
Okay, maybe I'm talking about a different one.
No, The Hand That Rocks the Cradle. It's a horror movie.
Yeah.
With the blonde actress.
Yeah.
I forget her name. And her husband is accused of sexually molesting other women because he was an OBGYN.
No.
And the lady that brought the charges against her husband, she gets revenge on him because her husband commits suicide.
Oh.
And so she wants to get revenge on this lady by posing as a nanny for her new baby. Because she lost her child.
Oh, maybe that is the one.
Yes.
No, I was thinking the one with the tree. This lady's like... Anyway.
So anyway, she lost her baby when her husband killed himself because of her grief. She had a miscarriage, and so she's taking it out on this woman that accused her husband.
And all this is in this song?
No, not this song. This song came out. This song came out.
Like, wow, you're really reading into this. Like, okay, there's this whole story. She was young.
No.
She didn't know what she was. She had a kid.
So from what I feel on this is that a woman loses her child, is haunted by the child, and doesn't know what else to do because she's just kind of beside herself because you lose your child and it's a huge thing. I mean, when Kaz was born, and Mark can attest to this because he used to live with us, I would have these nightmares, these horrible, horrible nightmares where Kaz, as a little baby, would come crawling to me and then just fall down a hole and I couldn't stop him.
What?
Or I'd be up on a big ladder.
That's
and there's
scary.
Kaz right there. Yeah. And
then there's this one where he was like spinning in front of the TV.
That wasn't a dream. That was real,
man. Yeah.
Okay, so what does he say at the very end, though? Okay, listen to this.
I'm here and here I'll stay.
I know this.
Yeah. I did my best for her. What's he talking about? Okay, but then. Wait. Oh no, he didn't.
So.
Where did you say? Okay.
What are you trying to look for?
There's this part where it sounds like he says, "And your mother, she must never know," or something. Or. Do you know what I'm talking about? But it doesn't say it in the lyrics. Kind of something. But
so
who is he talking about? I did my best for her.
That's what I'm saying. I don't think it's something that is like. Like an autobiography type thing. I think he's making it more of like a soap opera in a song.
Yeah.
To where a woman and again this is just me, but a woman loses her child, has horrible, horrible hauntings about losing her child, and then the person that's there with her is trying to comfort her, and there's a huge storm outside, and it's causing her even more grief, and he's trying to comfort her the entire time, realizes there's nothing he can do about it, and here's the scandalous part, there will be blood on the cleaver tonight. He takes her life.
What? I thought that was just part of the ghostly part. He kills her?
He takes her life, and that's why at the very end he's saying, I did my best for her because I couldn't do anything else.
Tried
and the
to
only
kill
way
her.
To stop... The only way to stop these nightmares for her was to take her life.
So obviously he wasn't, whether it was a kid or whatever, he was not the good caretaker.
That,
he couldn't do much.
That, well,
okay, that's interesting. I always thought it was like this kind of like protective, you know, lullaby kind of thing.
It was protective,
you know,
because the thing is when you get to that kind of, when you get to that kind of stage... I mean, you can't stop something like that, and the only way to stop the pain is to basically end it.
Well, it's funny that he kills somebody, and then the next song is This Charming Man.
Yeah.
Not very charming, I guess.
Ooh, you know what? Maybe this whole album is a soap opera.
Oh, yeah.
It's telling the same story.
Oh, I had a theory. I was like, okay, so... Oh, what is that? Bottom? I don't owe you anything... was answered by This Charming... Anyway, if it didn't work out, but...
No,
okay.
That's the way the Franz Ferdinand album is.
Yeah, tonight.
Tonight, Franz Ferdinand.
Oh, really?
Yeah, the whole album,
I mean,
from start to end...
I've listened to it,
all the songs are the same story.
Really?
Yeah, it goes through the entire story from the first song to the last song.
I wouldn't say it's the same story.
It is the same story.
The premise of the album is that it's all one party. I think it just... each song is like from a different perspective. So I guess that's the same story, but you know.
Sorry, right, man.
So, the next track is this charming.
Is this charming man? Yeah. Alright, this charming man. I mean, this is like, okay, so you go, I'm just saying, you go from kind of the downer, which would be side one.
Yep.
Side A, to B side, all of a sudden, boom. Just
yeah.
Starts, picks up. Why didn't this album start off like that? I don't get it. Why didn't they start it off like...
You know why?
Why?
I have a theory on this. Sorry, Kaz.
We're just talking about the album, not the song. You get it, though,
so,
Kaz.
I have a theory on this, and the way I came to this theory is by watching American Idol. If you watch, no, seriously, if you watch American Idol, it seems the judges and the audience seems to like the slower songs more than the faster upbeat songs. Because anytime a contestant would sing a faster, upbeat song, the judges would be like, yeah, it's good, but it wasn't
pitchy.
Your best effort. And,
a little pitchy.
Yeah, you got the, and, but they do a slow song, they're like, man, that was the best, dog. Look at that. You are so on right now. And I think that was kind of...
Okay.
That's my theory, is that they felt the slower songs would hook them onto side A, and then you get to side B, and you can do the more cheerful stuff.
Yeah, it's just weird.
I know.
I want to put down, like... All of a sudden, you're like, oh my gosh, you know, this charming man would have been the perfect start for this album. Take it.
Go, Kaz.
I don't agree.
No!
I think Rail Around the Fountain is the perfect start to this
album.
It's a bit like opening a door. Like the drum beat at the beginning of Rail Around the Fountain is like walking in. But we're not talking about Rail Around the Fountain anymore. This charming man. I have heard several things about this charming man. Most of them being that it's
who's
super
been talking
gay.
About me? Oh wait, no, I'm this charming man.
Yeah, no, but they were talking about you. They were saying super gay. no, but just like very coy and like under the radar, I guess.
Yeah, it's kind of it's weird lyric here. Let's get the lyrics out here for you. What?
Oh shit! What?
Where'd they go?
I got them.
This charming man.
Yeah.
Do you know what this?
I would go out
at?
Tonight, but I haven't.
It charted at number 25 on the UK charts. It's,
yeah.
Where's this charming? Oh, they don't have it in here because it wasn't. Oh, remember the whole debate we had?
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I remember. I lost paper, rock, scissors, but they don't have it in here because it wasn't on the actual album.
Yeah.
No, but like it.
The Brit.
It
know,
feels. Like, a lot of the words he uses have, like, this very strict imagery to them. Like,
the leather runs smooth on the passenger
yeah,
seat and all
like,
that.
Why pamper life's complexities is just, like, such a little... good little thing. And then, when the leather runs smooth on the passenger seat. So you've got that part, and then when the leather runs smooth. So you can kind of just imagine, like, stroking your hand on the leather seats or whatever.
I don't know. I think that's really saying he doesn't wipe after he goes to the bathroom.
No.
Wait. What, pamper? He wears pampers? He wears diapers, dude. Now, does Morsi wear boxers or briefs? The question is. And the answer is, depends. No, but I've never understood this song.
No,
you know, it kind of builds up this, because, oh, son
oh,
of a gun.
Somebody's calling.
Here, pause.
I can't see very
just
much.
Well.
All right.
Okay, so.
So going back to.
Oh, this
Morrissey,
charming man.
Morrissey wearing pampers.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so take it from there.
I don't understand all of this song, but honestly, it's just it's such a good Johnny Marr piece.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, it's very good musically.
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
Like everything is good in this song. The bass, the drums, the guitars.
Yeah, they all earn their the vocals.
Yeah.
Like they all Like, just the, yeah.
My favorite part of this song is that when they were doing one of the, like, promo videos for it, just, like, that they were going to air on one of the local stations, the director didn't like how Johnny Marr's face looked, so did not ever show Johnny Marr's face, only, like, up to right.
Oh, yeah. They were like, ooh, he's kind of, like, they're, anyway, yeah, I remember reading about that.
Yeah.
For some reason, yeah, he just kept on getting cut out.
Yeah.
But have you seen that one where they play this Charming Man with the school kids?
Yeah.
Yep. Like, and he does it acoustically or whatever?
Yeah, and the kids are just, this Charming
Like, they don't even know
man.
The freaking song.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, but then again, it was number 25, so, I mean, and they were little kids, so.
Yeah.
But it's great song.
It is a good song.
Wasn't ever on the first album.
Wasn't on the first album in the UK.
Yeah, in the UK.
Yeah.
I lost.
But in the States.
Definitive
lost.
Version of This Charming Man, definitely the New York version.
Oh, yeah.
Where they just had like three extra.
Well, see,
the same thing.
Yeah, because what happened was Mike Joyce, you know, he wanted.
He wanted 26%.
Well, he wanted the 26, so he bought an electric drum kit. And he talked to Troy Tate, and they snuck into the studio and added that on there. So.
Yeah, all right. Should we go on to the next one?
Joyce! Joyce is struck again. Okay.
Still ill. Okay, funny story about this. In my senior.
We're gonna play the track first.
Sorry, got ahead of myself.
And actually, this version is good. So is the other tune. I mean, anyway, like, listen to how much this album has picked up.
I'm gonna name names.
So, anywho, my friend, who we've mentioned before, Mark, not this Mark,
Mark
the Correa. Other the,
oh.
the Mark. Other Mark.
Yeah, we're gonna.
So, we didn't understand this, so. So anyway, we decided we were going to put song lyrics for this, and he picked,
You Lie in Your Breath Stink?
No.
I remember that song.
Yeah. No, he selected, what was it? Dead Milkman that did Bitchin' Camaro?
Yeah.
Yeah. So he did Bitchin' Camaro, you know, the little banter back and forth.
Yeah.
So he did that one. And, I did
hey,
Still
Jack.
Ill, but I changed England to America. So I wrote down, I decree today that life is simply taking and not giving. America is mine and owes me a living. Ask me why and I'll spit in your eye. But we cannot cling to the old dreams anymore. No, we cannot cling to those dreams. Does the body rule the mind or does the mind rule the body? I don't know. And she gave me an F for it.
What?
And I was like, wait a second. You just gave Morrissey an F.
How could she give you an F for that?
Probably because I didn't do the assignment right.
Oh, you didn't understand it. Okay, because I was like, those are actually pretty good. I like how he says, though, that he's like, you know, oh, well, England owes me a living, but ask me why, you know, and don't ask me why, because I don't even know. I don't have an argument for it, but, you know, I'll just get mad. It just does, okay? It just owes me.
What do you think, Kaz?
Yeah.
I think this is like the quintessential Smith song. When anybody is like, oh, what are the Smiths about? This will always be included in like the list of songs that I give them. It's got so many
things. It was on rank.
Yeah.
Well, then it's definitely it is. It's a good.
Yeah, no, just like it has everything from Morrissey's sense of entitlement to wish it to reminiscing about the old days. To slightly hinting that he gets more action than you do, even though you know he doesn't. And just, like, jabs at people in general. As well, one of the best Johnny Marr riffs that has ever, like, come out of his guitar, I guess.
For this?
Yeah. This is a... If you listen to, like, everything that Johnny Marr does on this...
Okay.
He goes all over the place. He goes all over the neck of the guitar, and it's just super cool.
Let's listen a little bit more. I'm not giving, England is mine. dangly guitar.
Yeah.
So what's you mean still, what's the still ill part? Like, what's...
Still gay.
Okay. I guess that was at least at some time considered an illness.
Yeah, no.
But
I don't know. That's one interpretation. Well, it could just mean I still don't know what to do with myself. I'm still ill.
Still have a problem.
Yeah.
Like, because he's like, you know, he's making out with this girl or whatever, you know, that
under the iron bridge,
but it's just not like the old days. So what's my problem? Am I still ill? You know,
yeah.
What is my problem? Is it, you know, I don't know.
I can tell you what your problem is.
No, that was a rhetorical question. No answer needed. So, yeah, but so he's, you know, but I mean, he brings up some important issues or,
like,
you know, thoughtful, but does the body rule the mind or does the mind rule the body? You know, just kind of that age-old struggle, you know?
Yeah, I love that line.
And we all know the body wins, so.
And I love the line. I love
saying the body electric.
I love the line, for there are brighter sides to life and I should know because I've seen them, but not very often, because it's like, it gives you a bunch of hope, and then Morrissey is like, but I haven't seen that a lot, so I mean... You know.
So don't take it from me.
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing, though. You don't want to take any advice from Morrissey.
Yeah, it's a very Morrissey line. Like, it gives you a lot of hope. And then he's like, but, like, that's not me. I've never had anything good happen to me in my life ever.
Yeah. But it's like, you know, and what is the one where he's like, I need advice.
Miserable lie.
He's asking for advice. But then in these later songs, he's giving out advice. And it's like, dude.
Yeah.
You haven't had a relationship last for...
More than 15 minutes.
Yeah, and if truth be told...
it's not really 15 minutes.
Yeah.
So, okay,
anyway.
What about the next one?
The next song...
So the next one is Hand in Glove.
Oh, Hand in Glove. Great song.
Oh, gosh. What a good song.
I like the music on this.
Oh, does Andy give it to you? Okay. This version is not my favorite version of it, though.
No.
I mean, it's just, I mean, it's a great song.
But this one is just like, it's there.
Mm. Yeah, it just...
I don't know.
Recording issues, you know.
I think that the single version is better where they have the fade in, but I think it's very good that they didn't use the single version for the album.
Yeah, so it gives you something different. I mean, so you get the album with the song, but it's a different version.
Yeah.
But it's a worse version, so is it really that good of a thing? That's the question. The lyrics always kind of bewildered me. You know, I always thought it was funny because it's like, yeah, the sun shines out of your behinds, you know? But there's that, I guess, an old saying, you know, oh, you think the sun shines out of your arse? Yeah. So he's saying, yeah, it does. And that's cute. But I always liked this song because, you know, I mean, I was... You know, I always dressed a little different from, you know, main people, you know, or mainstream. You know, I was in alternative music and stuff and had my hair different, whatever. But I always could relate to it because I'm like, yeah, man, you know, we might wear these weird clothes or whatever, but, you know, we're happy and whatever. Screw everybody else. You know, we get to do what we want. So,
yeah.
That was my
I think this is one of the, like, few Smith songs that is purely a love song. Like, it's not, like, a huge lasting thing, but it's, like, the last line is, I'll probably never see you again. It's Morrissey being like, you know what, I'll probably never see you again, but while we're here and while it's right now, we're going to be happy.
Well, then that would be like Stretch Out and Wait. It's a love song, too.
Yeah.
No. You know what a good love song is? I Know It's Over.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's great.
Love song for Johnny Marr.
What?
I said it's a love song for Johnny Marr.
It is?
Yeah, I know it's over.
Yeah.
No, I won't share you is about Johnny Marr.
I won't share you. And also he's with the Pretenders. Like, oh, I guess I'm going to have to share you. So he's in South America touring with the Pretenders.
Okay, but that's a different...
I mean, this is a great song. Like I said, suddenly the B-side is just like... Boing, 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 boing.
So what difference does it make?
Oh, man, I don't even want to play that one.
Why?
Because it's such a crappy version.
Yes. What difference does it
make
on this one?
It doesn't have, like, any of the... whenever you hear the one from Alpha Half, from the Peel Sessions, you're like, whoa, this is what the song should have been. And that was out before...
skip that song and do that on Hatful.
This, real quickly, this one has a lot of, like, frills to it, I guess. Like, the version.
Yeah, it's overproduced.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. Whenever you hear the Peel one, it's pretty raw, and even Morrissey's vocals are raw, and that's the way this song needs to be. It's just, like, works perfect.
Honestly, though, it was such a good song for, like, Top of the Pops.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, so next one. I don't
owe
you any... What?
Oh, wait, we don't want to...
We're not going to discuss that one. We're going to discuss it on...
Well, Apple. this is Morrissey, though Morrissey's ashamed of this song for some reason. Their least favorite. No.
What? It's Morrissey's least favorite?
Yeah, and I'm like, this is actually... You get the right version, it's actually one of my top Smith songs. Okay, let's just move on.
All right.
Yeah.
We'll talk,
about it. Just listen to this lame intro. It kind of does his fade in. I mean, but imagine it like... And then drums like... Oh, it's just that...
I'd like to get like an a cappella version of this first Smiths album by you.
By me?
Yeah, so like you're...
No, you don't,
you're,
man.
You're doing all the drums, you're doing the bass line with your mouth.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I was gonna.
Yeah.
Okay. So what's that? I don't owe you anything.
I don't owe you anything.
Which is like, but I think, and I don't owe you anything. I think that's the person that he's singing about that's saying that.
I think really you have to look.
Do you think he's saying it or somebody else is?
Well, he wrote this song for Sandy Shaw. Like, to be performed by Sandy Shaw. So I kind of think that it's written to be a Sandy Shaw song, and I think it kind of should have been a B-side.
You know?
Yeah.
Morrissey seems to do a lot of that, and I don't understand that. Like, he wrote Let Me Kiss You for Nancy Sinatra. Nancy Sinatra records it, and then he records it. So it's like...
Oh, that's like that Please Help the Cause.
Yeah.
Which he just totally... screwed it up, like, so,
please,
it's like, he oversang it.
Yeah, I'm no, like, it, like, if you listen to the Sandy Shaw version,
yeah, it's like,
it's so fun.
Yeah, and then, like,
yeah, it's
okay.
Like, if you're going to write a song for somebody else, let them sing the song.
Yeah.
Don't take it.
I'm saying, like, if you listen to the Troy Tate ones on this song, like... So you got that little but if you listen to Troy Tate one, it's even more so, like you're saying with Sandy Shaw, the 60s kind of, so it's even more like even that 60s sound. I wish actually Johnny Marr didn't want to do everything, like he wanted to kind of change up how the guitar is played, so he probably made the decision to somehow turn that down so it didn't sound too much like anything else.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do I know?
I actually kind of adore all the Sandy Shaw Smith songs, if you kind of view them as a little bit differently than Smith songs, but as Sandy Shaw songs.
Well, okay. That's a good opinion you got there. No, I do like some of hers, you know, but I don't like all of them. Like, we'll have to look at them, because actually I got a CD with some of them on them. But But this song's kind of...
They're not my favorite.
Yeah, I mean, but it was Sandy Shaw, you know? I mean, it wasn't the Smiths, so they don't have to be our favorites. I mean,
yeah.
But I'm saying it was nice of her to come over and sing with them.
Yeah.
She's trying to muscle into Morrissey's territory.
There was a live version of Sandy Shaw doing something because Morrissey went off stage to do like
I've seen it.
A wardrobe change. And he comes back on and everybody's clapping for Sandy Shaw. And he's like, oh, I've been replaced, huh?
but he was being... what happened is she... he wrote, you know, she wanted him to write her some songs. So she's like, okay, I got up to number 20-something in the charts with this song.
Yeah.
I need you to write me a hit now, you know, Morrissey,
yeah.
You know. And this is 30 years later, and Morrissey's just so upset at her, you know, still holding a grudge, you know. Because basically he was lending his band to her so she could get hits, and he wasn't getting any money off of it or anything. Which, hey...
So,
anyway,
you could say he pulled a Mike Joyce.
This is definitely her saying, I don't owe you anything. I'm just borrowing your band and your songs, and I'm making all the money. And that went all the way to the bank. Okay, so let's get to the last song.
Suffer the
Which
Children.
Is one that Steve said in the thing, in our premiere
episode
that this was one, a must listen. Do you want to...
Yes.
I mean, this...
Let's play it.
Over the moor, take me to the moor, dig a shallow grave, and I'll lay me down.
Okay, so we'll just...
This angered the Manchester community... Huge.
Oh, yeah.
Huge.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until Morrissey spoke to one of the mothers of the murdered children.
Well, tell them what it's about.
Okay, so the song is about the Morris murders. And so basically what had happened was there was a maniac running around that area. Two.
Yeah.
There were two maniacs running around that area, basically abducting children, abusing them, and then basically killing them and then burying them under, you know, hardly anything in the moors. And there was a big investigation on it. Huge, huge story.
And it's all something that Morrissey and Johnny Marr and
I'm sure
Rourke and Joyce,
they all
remembered it. And people that knew these kids, and they were from their neighborhoods and stuff.
Yeah,
so it's something
that major thing
that they grew up knowing.
Yeah, and he wrote this, from what I understand, Morrissey wrote this so that it was an anthem to the children and honoring them and basically giving them the justice that these maniacs could not silence them and could not keep them down. And it was not taken that way by the community. And the community had a huge outcry about this. Everybody was calling to ban the Smiths album. They wanted everybody to ban the Smiths from being played on the radio, from playing in local music halls. And Morrissey met with the mother of one of the victims and explained the song to her. She understood. She finally started coming around, seeing what it was, and she basically got all of this to stop and saying, this is not what we think it is. He's not trying to capitalize on our grief. He's actually doing this as an anthem for us.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it also set very early on a real case of the Smiths versus the media. The Sun was just relentlessly trying to destroy the Smiths.
Yeah.
Also, the mother heard this song in like a restaurant or diner. Who plays this song in a restaurant?
Well,
it's
anyone.
So
it's not. Yeah, that's true.
It wasn't like they even had a single of it. Like it wasn't like a jukebox or anything.
Smith's fan. Maybe it's Smith's fan's restaurant.
Yeah.
So.
But there's really nice imagery about Leslie Ann and her pretty white beads and,
yep.
you know, all these different things and just that they were, I mean, I think some of the bodies were recovered, but some weren't, and they're just out in the moors somewhere, and
yeah.
it's just a nice tribute, beautiful song. I mean, you know, the guitar and everything,
beautiful bass line. I mean,
yeah.
everything just fits together so well in this song.
Yeah,
and even the lyrics.
Why did they start the song,
the album with this
with
song?
This song?
Oh, this is the one of the best ways to end this album.
Yeah.
Like, have you ever heard, I can't even think.
Weird Al Yankovic running the scissors?
Yeah. No, but like.
Mr. Bo Peel?
No, but like, the rise and fall of Ziggy Stardust and the Spiders from Mars.
You know,
Suicide was the best possible song to end that album.
I need to listen
song.
To more David Bowie. I've never, you know, I like some of his stuff, but I've never really listened to it.
Well,
and you can't get it free on Amazon Prime, so.
So, here's the thing: the Smiths' first album is one thing that I think is a great album.
Well, yeah, especially because, I mean, it's a great album, especially because they're just 2 years or a year and a half into their.
Yeah, they started recording this late '83.
Okay, so
it's
before. Before we sign off.
Okay.
We're gonna pick our top two songs from this album.
Oh, okay.
I can already tell you my top two.
Go for it.
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle and Suffer Little Children.
You said that last time.
Exactly. I said that the two in episode one I said the two songs you want to hear if you're not familiar with Smiths is This Charming Man and Suffer Little Children. That's absolutely true, but my two favorite tracks from this album are The Hand That Rocks the Cradle and Suffer Little Children. Those are my two absolute favorite.
Wait, The Hand That Rocks the Cradle?
The Hand That Rocks the Cradle.
Oh. You're sad. You like sad songs.
All right,
you
next.
I like...
Okay, I think I'm going to go with... I don't know why I didn't even think that this would be a question that we would have. But I think I'm going to go with This Charming Man,
mm-hmm.
you know, and Still Ill.
Good choices.
I think
Mark is the perfect opposite to me because I like the more
sad,
downer
sad.
Stuff and he likes
sad,
all the more upbeat stuff.
I'm kind of right in the middle. I really like Still Ill and I really like Suffer Little Children.
You guys like to see kids suffer.
I'm just joking. Who are you, the son?
Yeah, that's right. So two for Suffer a Little. Okay, Paper, Rock, Scissors. Whoever
okay.
wins.
We've also
okay.
got two for Still Ill.
Oh, good.
Ooh, so which one is the
so,
best
no,
song
no, no.
on this album?
No, so, okay, basically, out of the three of us, the two best songs are Still Ill and Suffer Little Children.
Yes.
The majority. So, anyway.
The best song? Paper, Rock, Scissors. Come on.
I don't
wait,
remember
for
that
what?
On the album.
For the best song on the album.
Whoever wins gets it?
Yep.
Wait, so, I mean, but what are we paper, rock, scissoring for?
I can't be a part of this.
Just so we can beat you.
Oh, I know, but you're like, go paper. That's good. Go paper.
I was like, go paper.
Oh, wait. It's two against one, man. Yeah, that was so funny when I realized that. Anyway, that's the callback to the original podcast.
Kaz, you were going to say something?
Yeah.
I wasn't going to say anything. I thought I was going to say something. Did not actually have anything.
All right, guys. Well, that wraps up our first one. Our first
second.
Full album.
First
oh,
full
yeah.
album.
A part two.
Yeah, Rambo 3.
First album, part two.
I'm going to force him to watch all the damn Rambo movies.
I've seen the Rambo
back
movies.
Back to back.
Remember when he helps Osama bin Laden in Afghanistan? Basically, everybody's rooting for that. A blowback, man. It's real.
You know what the best Rambo was? You know what the best Rambo was? The clip from UHF.
Oh, yeah.
They're standing right next to each other, shooting
Dude,
each other.
Well, yeah, Weird Al is every man, and every man as he should be.
Exactly.
Weird Al Yankovic.
All right.
All right, so we're signing off.
Little prompt, I guess. What's your favorite song from this album? Or even better yet, what is a song that you think does better on this album than any other recording?
Ooh, that's a good one.
Ooh, I don't know.
You know what?
I'm still going to have to go back on 45.
All right.
Okay. Anyway, signing off.
Yeah.
For this charming Smithscast, we're going to get it down. We're these handsome
hooligans.
We're the handsome hooligans. We got
Stephen,
Casimir,
and Mark.
Right
Keep
on.
The faith.
Okay.
Thank you. Or do you want to play something?
Let's play it out.
With the sad song.
Take me to moon. Dig a shallow grave.
We all did look awful.